Thank you, Kent. That was positively provocative. And I'm hoping I can meet that standard. This is a little more wonky of a presentation if you are getting into the weeds of some of the metrics and the ways that we're looking at it. But this panel really aims to look at whether the current scholarly publishing ecosystem is in a good position to deliver real-world impact and how we're doing it. And Elsevier is evolving our research metric strategy to empower scholars and researchers to claim the narrative of what they do and why it matters. And I'll just say at the outset, Elsevier is a sponsor of something called the Golden Goose Awards. I don't know how many of you are familiar with that, but it's actually an award that's given out as a response to what were the Golden Fleece Awards. So initially, it was research that was deemed sort of a boondoggle by Congress called and it was called the Golden Fleece. And in response to that, the Golden Goose Awards was developed for the research that was so nascent that it kind of laid an egg for future productivity and reaped rewards sometimes decades into the future. So we sponsor that in full recognition of the fact that the immediate impact of research is not always available, even as we're trying to capture in increasing ways and through more transparent metrics various ways in which these things are developing. I'm going to force march you through this little agenda. I have a few slides, but it's very late in the day. I'll just give some context about RELX and Elsevier and metrics. I want to talk briefly about how metrics are used across the research lifecycle and talk about metrics capture and visualization through various tools, including PlumX, and more importantly, move on to analytics that we're working on that really measure real-world impact, which includes something new called Topics of Prominence, which is in our SciVal suite, and also talk about some of the societal challenges that we're trying to address through those analytics. So, with apologies to anybody who was at the AI presentation earlier today, this is one duplicate slide of something I showed then, but just to put Elsevier in context with our parent company, because I think it's really important. For those of you who don't, I'm sure everybody here knows Elsevier. You may not be as familiar with our parent RELX group. Those initials actually stand for something. The R stands for Risk Solutions, which is our fastest growing division, and is sitting on a huge trove of data, everything from bankruptcy records to auto insurance records to medical claims data. The E, of course, is Elsevier, working with about 17% of the world's scientific information, including more than 70 million citations in our Scopus database, which is the backbone of a lot of our research. The L stands for LexisNexis, which is our legal and news division, where we have a tremendous amount of data coming in. And I think it's 60% of global legal policy publications are published by LexisNexis. And then the X is for exhibitions, and we run, 500 events in 40 countries with more than 6 million attendees per year. All of that is data that could, in theory, be used to develop metrics for everything from social determinants of health to something that I'm working on and I'll come on in the end, but measuring science impact on policy, which is a really interesting way to look at real-world impact of scientific publication. I think some of my colleagues here have already noted metrics use cases across the research life cycle, and we've spent a good deal of time thinking about how we look at awards for funding and measure research outputs through citation and visibility of data repositories and blogs to really more actively looking at levels of researcher engagement. So how are we looking at researchers' collaboration? How are we looking at their mobility? How are we crowdsourcing information? And finally, looking at societal impact, as I just discussed, and looking at ways in which we can measure understanding of research and the influence of that on big societal challenges. Evaluation of research frameworks is not new. REF was already mentioned earlier, and I think it's important to know that we actively work with both REF in the UK, and we also provide information for the BIS report, which is the Business Engineering and Information Strategy Framework therein. An older but equally interesting initiative in the US started at Washington University in St. Louis, and I liked the taxonomy for evaluating some of these research projects, which included looking at a piece of research benchmarked against the following criteria advancement of knowledge, clinical implementation? Did it figure into legislation and policy? What was the economic benefit? And what was the community benefit? And the closer that we can get to metrics that really work within that framework, I think the better off research will be. And more importantly, the funding for research will also increase, because I think we have a long way to go in convincing taxpayers that what they're paying for is of value to them. And I fear that with the media onslaught that Ken was mentioning, we actually become more distanced from this rather than the reverse. So one way in which we develop metrics is through thoughtful and rigorous development of the various components that figure into it. And I just wanted to touch on CiteScore, which was a metric that we developed, a simple new metric for all the journals that were indexed in Scopus. And it's a three-year citation metric that looks at items from 3 years as opposed to some of the ISI measurements, and actually is an average of the articles cited within the journal itself. So we sought to make that methodology more transparent, and also to have folks understand that there are alternatives within journal assessments. But again, that citation and journal metric in particular is a lagging indicator, and the timeline from idea to impact is very long. It can take 2 to 5 years from idea to published article. I'm sorry, it can take 2 to 5 years from an idea to become a published article in a peer-reviewed journal. And due to the pace of scholarly publishing, it can take another 3 to 5 years from the time the work is published to get a critical mass of citation counts. That's a very old paradigm. And what we're looking at is a new paradigm of new metrics that are available more immediately. I'm very conscious of something that David said early on, though, which is that attention is not the same as impact. And I don't think we're really convinced that a number of presentation views or data set downloads or PDF downloads or bookmarks or video plays or number of Facebook shares are reliable metrics. And we have to be aware of these, we have to work with these, but we also have to monitor these very carefully. I think that Kent and David's presentations indicated that. We're actually working through our suite of Plum Analytics to capture multiple sources of research metrics, and that includes many of these listed here, you can see, and also artifact types. So lots of forms of research output are captured by Plum Analytics. There are 67, in fact, which includes everything from articles to theses and dissertation and books and conference papers and reviews, as well as government documents. And they've categorized them into buckets of more understandable metric types, including usage, as I just said, captures, as well as mentions, social media, and citations itself. And then with Plum, we visualize scholarly engagement through something called a Plum print, so that any researcher can see the results of their research within those 5 categories of metrics, which is designed to communicate a level of engagement without a score. So I think that's also very helpful in determining and not labeling various types of research work. One of the reasons that I wanted to raise Plum, though, was to talk about how they're measuring societal impact. And we actually index policy documents from different types of organizations, including nonprofits, government agencies, NGOs, and think tanks. And the policy documents can be anything from guidelines to white papers to monographs to pamphlets to articles. And they're continuing to index these because a lot of times the influence that a piece of research has extends far beyond just citation in another journal. It can impact those works. So switching from Plum, I just wanted to also say that we are also looking closely at developing metrics for research data and assigning values for whether things are stored, published, linked, and validated. And we're recognizing increasingly that data in and of itself also has a role to play in how research is perceived. We use these metrics and also the data that rolls up into these metrics in various products that Elsevier works with leading institutions on developing and also to benchmark their performance. And SciVal is a tool that we've developed that is a layer that sits on top of the Scopus database. And you can see here the number of metrics that institutions can consult for both individuals and their own institutions within that framework. And so some of them are pretty obvious, like scholarly output, number of publications, but there are other less obvious metrics like academic corporate collaboration. And so one of the favorite things that we do with institutions is to look at how they're collaborating with industry, but SciVal can also give you the delta of who they're not collaborating with. And that is a signal to them where they might want to develop businesses and also really evolve some of their research into more applied areas. I also wanted to introduce you to topics of prominence, which we perceive as an early identification of research impact. This is very, very new in the SciVal suite, but as I referenced earlier, previously you could look at an institution and benchmark their performance within various subject categories. So that was mapped along something called the ASJC codes, very traditional. You could look at University of Irvine in computer science, and then underneath that would be artificial intelligence and all of those predictable subject categories. But it was finite, less than 300. What Topics of Prominence did was use artificial intelligence to map co-citation rates. So the minute a paper cited another paper, and this is a very simple explanation, but it becomes a subject area, resulting in more than 100,000 subject areas where we can track institutional individual performance therein. So instead of just computer science, artificial intelligence, you can look at who is the leader in multi-agent systems, and you can see how research in that area is growing. And it gives you not only a metric of success in that area, but also an indicator of where you might want to invest funds as a funder or at an institution. Here's an example of what a Topics of Prominence tableau looks like. This is for University of California at Irvine. And you can see, you know, there's some big physics papers which give a huge, they kind of distort, I think, the very top levels of that metric. But in other areas, who knew that they were looking at aerosols and aerosol formation and smog chambers or carcinoma and small cell lung development? When we can look at where the science is actually being performed and how collaboration networks are being formed therein, this is a really valuable indicator of the direction in which science is going. And this can become applied. We can look at some of the other indicators that I discussed earlier to take that research and really turn it into something that indicates real-world impact through practical solutions working with patents, dare I say it, and industry collaborators. All right, two more things before I'm done. I'm conscious of time here, but we also use our analytics capabilities to look at citation analysis in the areas of real-world challenges through our analytics reports. We recently published a global outlook on disaster science, where we actually created a taxonomy to look at where disaster research is being done and looking at risk and recovery metrics. So we were able to segment the whole Scopus corpus, 70 million citations, into areas of prevention, preparedness, response, and recovery, and also look at where various research is being done along the lines of disaster types, whether it be geophysical, meteorological, chemical, and radiology, or biological disasters. And that's an indication to the countries that were benchmarked therein and the institutions therein where the research is happening and where we need to do more globally in an effort to ramp up our efforts there. We also use a lot of our analytics insight to inform policy. So for example, we did a report on the percentage of all opioid referencing research focused on addiction from 1950 to 2016. Again, looking at ways in which scientific research is having an impact on this large societal challenge. Again, not a metric, but it's a dialogue, and it's a trajectory of how we're working to help others. And finally, my small pet project that I've been working on for a couple of years with a very small dedicated team of in-house folks is looking at science in the legislative data. We have been working across our groups with folks in LexisNexis to look at the Federal Register and the congressional hearing data and unearth citations. You can see at the bottom of this, you can see an actual citation to annual reviews in 2004, lead poisoning in the congressional record. And this is really fascinating, and I will tell you this challenge that we have is the fact that within that government data, the science isn't cited cleanly, right? Nobody ever provides you with a DOI. We're lucky to have that little reference that is just so clean. So what we're looking at now is sort of clustering of content discussions within both sets of documents so that we can see. But imagine if we could actually trace lead in water to some policy regulation that may yet happen in Flint, Michigan. That's the holy grail of saying this piece of funded research got translated into this scientific article that affected these people positively in this way because a law changed. So that's the vision. We are advocates of responsible metrics, and I thank you for your time today. Okay.